After weeks of desperate conditions, refugees finally cross into Germany. The EU's current migration policies seem to be crumbling. Is Europe entering a brand new era of border policy? Who's in control and will it work? This is Inside Story. Hello and welcome to the show. I'm Sami Zeidan. It's the story gripping the world right now, Europe's refugee crisis. We've seen incredible pictures showing tens of thousands of refugees in Greece all the way to Germany, risking everything to escape war and persecution. A deeply disturbing yet now iconic photo of a three-year-old Syrian boy who drowned on a Turkish beach has become a symbol of their plight. Well, now, some relief. Thousands of refugees are arriving in Germany, with thousands more still to come. It's been the dream destination for many, but confusion continues. European leaders remain divided over how to deal with the large number of refugees. They're yet to put forward a concrete or unified plan. Hungary has taken a tough approach, for example, while France and Germany are pushing for a common EU asylum system with a permanent quota for each country.
We have to strengthen even more our cooperation and work together without any kind of blame game among us Europeans, being member states, being candidate countries, being institutions. We are all facing a dramatic event. I don't say an emergency event because this is here to stay. This is not an emergency. It's an urgency we are facing, but it is not something that starts that day and finishes that day. It is here to stay. And the sooner we accept it psychologically and politically, the sooner we will be able to respond in an effective way and to manage in an effective way.
Well, these refugees are following two main migration routes into Europe. One begins in Libya, where thousands of refugees have been boarding ships to Italy. From there, they travel on to France and Germany. Now, the other route is mostly Syrian refugees traveling into Turkey and onto Kos in Greece. The path continues on through Macedonia and Serbia into Hungary. Now, that's where thousands waited for days before moving on to Austria and Germany. Most of these refugees say Germany is their final destination. More than 100,000 refugees entered the country in August, and Germany expects 800,000 refugees and migrants this year, four times last year's level. Well, time to bring in our guests. In Oxford, Jeff Crisp, honorary advisor at Refugees International and former head of policy development at the UNHCR. In London, Gauri Van Gulik, deputy director of Amnesty International in Europe and Central Asia. And in Washington, D.C., Demetrios Papandemetriou, co-founder and president of the Migration Policy Institute Europe. Welcome to you all. Let's start with Demetrios, if we could. You know, what we've been seeing for days on our TV screens is been these incredible scenes of refugees in Budapest, and now suddenly they're all heading towards Germany via Austria. Why? What changed?
Well, certainly what changed was the position of the Austrian government, which only a few days ago announced that it would effectively suspend the Schengen agreement within the European Union that allows for the entry of people from one country to another without any checks, any procedures. And the Austrian Minister of the Interior announced that although she was not reinstituting border controls, she was going to institute and maintain indefinitely checks, spot checks. And of course, Hungary has always wanted to make sure that Hungary would not be stuck, as it were, with tens of thousands and eventually possibly 100 or more thousand Syrians that would make it to Hungary but then couldn't move on to where it is that they all seem to want to go, which primarily Germany and secondarily Sweden.
So Dimitris, if I can jump in here, surely a lot of politicking must have taken place perhaps in smoky rooms behind the scenes between Germany, Austria and Budapest for these people to suddenly be given the green light, even bust across borders now.
Absolutely. We have had a very clear indication for about 10 days now that Chancellor Merkel was going to exert as much pressure, influence, use as much political capital as it is necessary for that part of the European Union, the eastern part of the European Union, to play the game by the rules and the values that the European Union stands for. It is very unusual for Frau Merkel to actually lead. She typically leads from behind and pushes from behind. She's a very cautious person. But clearly a decision was made about 10 days ago after a meeting with President Hollande of France that they were going to really exert pressure on the fellow member states of the European Union to actually open up to this. So as a result, we're in an entirely new chapter.
Interesting point there. I'm going to pick up on it with Jeff in a moment, but perhaps this is a good point to remind ourselves that there are several EU rules which complicate the migration crisis, you could say. One of them is the Dublin regulation. It establishes the principle that only one member state is responsible for examining an asylum application. The aim is to avoid asylum seekers from being sent from one country to another. Now, according to that principle, the first member state which the asylum application is lodged with is responsible for examining and processing it. Now, in some ways, that's a bit of a contrast with the Schengen Agreement. Most of the European Union, of course, is part of what is called the Schengen area. Now, it represents a territory where the free movement of persons is guaranteed. The signatory states to the agreement have abolished all internal borders in lieu of a single external border. Jeff, picking up on what Dimitris was describing there, it sounds like basically Germany here taking the initiative and kind of working out a de facto new European immigration or border policy. Is that what we're witnessing?
Well, I think you're right. It has been very much left to Germany and to Angela Merkel in particular to take the lead on this particular issue. I think we need to remember that the arrival of asylum seekers in Europe from other parts of the world is by no means a new phenomenon. It's become more visual. It's become larger in scale in recent times, but it's by no means a new phenomenon. But the EU has tended to react to it in a kind of ad hoc piecemeal way and has never really been able to introduce a comprehensive approach. And the current mess that we see in Europe is very much a result of the fact that there is no coherent approach and that states are acting very much in what they perceive to be their national interests rather than as a union of countries with common interests and common values, as Angela Merkel herself has pointed out.
Okay,
so yes,
but
Germany
Jeff,
is
the,
taking
the
a
fact,
lead.
The fact now that there does seem to be, I mean, there does seem to be some form of de facto coordination, if not common policy, between some of the EU states, because they're all heading towards Germany, and several countries seem to be assisting in that process. What is this new unwritten de facto policy, if not de jure policy?
Well, the policy at the moment seems to be that Germany will admit the vast majority of the asylum seekers are arriving in the region. But I think, you know, we're very much in a very fluid situation. If we take the situation here in the UK, for example, just 48 hours ago, Prime Minister David Cameron was very adamant that he would not be admitting any additional Syrian refugees. And it just took the publication of that photo and the public outcry that led to a very swift change of policy. So I think we're currently in a very fluid situation, and it's actually quite difficult to predict how things are going to play out over the next days and weeks.
Gauri, you, of course, are in contact with refugees. You monitor what's going on. What are they being told at this point when they're getting onto buses? What are they being told will happen to them, where they'll be settled, et cetera, et cetera?
People know very little. They're told very little. And frankly, I have the sense that most governments at the moment still don't know what's going to happen to them. I mean, I want to emphasize that there's very much a sense that countries are playing catch up. It's not as if we're seeing strong leadership, clear policies. It's basically countries accepting and dealing with what is reality. And it's very much actually due to actions by refugees themselves. So this huge group that suddenly started walking after being stuck on a train in Hungary, that is what caused, in the end, this breakthrough, rather than only governments deciding that they would handle it a little bit differently. But just to be very clear, we're very much in the middle of this still. Thousands of people are still arriving now, right now, today, on the border from Serbia into Hungary. And, for example, just this morning, we got a phone call from a boat in trouble off the coast of Greece, asking for help from the Coast Guard. I mean, this is a continuing situation. It's by no means changed. So if this sort of march of hope, this small bit of breakthrough that we're seeing is any indication, it will only have hope and real breakthrough if this results in actual measures by the governments. And this requires some serious leadership, some quick thinking, and some comprehensive packages that we've certainly proposed to them many times before. I hope this triggers it and it finally results in some proper policies that can handle the situation.
Gary mentioned there the march. Let's just take a moment now to stop and reflect on these pictures. There we go. Pictures of refugees and migrants marching from Budapest to the Austrian border on Friday afternoon. Now, perhaps what's really remarkable about these pictures is when you take into consideration the fact that EU border policy apparently crumbling beneath their feet, the feet not of an army, but the feet of these desperate refugees, armed only, mostly with their baby strollers and teddy bears and bags of whatever food they have. Jeff, do you think this is going to lead to the borders being tightened or relaxed in the face of refugees? Is it too early to read the tea leaves of where this is going to leave borders in Europe?
Well, it is very difficult to predict the future, but as your previous guest said, I mean, I think governments may try to close their borders, and indeed governments have tried to close their borders. Hungary has built a fence along its border with Serbia with the precise intention of keeping people out. I think the remarkable thing about the last 48 hours has been, just as your previous guest said, that refugees, who we often think of as being helpless and dependent people, have actually shown themselves to be very strong, very purposeful, have a very clear idea of where they want to go and what they want to do in their life, and have actually done that, irrespective of the restrictions placed upon them.
Gowrie, I'm glad that Jeff there mentioned the fact that we should keep in mind, while we're looking at pictures of refugees marching from Hungary, the Hungarian Parliament, of course, on Friday passing measures which will effectively seal the border by September the 15th. What, from your information interacting with these people, what do they plan to do? Is that the end of the story and they stay in their home countries? Or should we expect other routes and migration patterns to simply form around Hungary as they look for other ways to get into Europe?
What we've seen over and over and over again is when one fence gets built, another route is found. There is no doubt in my mind that this will in any way deter people from coming in general, because the push factors are so great. I mean, think about what they're fleeing. Most of these people are from conflict zones, for example, Syria, now a very large proportion of the group. They're not going to be stopped by this because they need safety and they're entitled to it. But what's important to note is that it's not just a physical fence that's being built that's going to keep people out and this sort of policy of trying to block the border. It's also legal changes, a little bit less visible and less noticeable, but legal changes, incredibly importantly right now, are making it impossible for people coming through Serbia in the end to get a full procedure, so a full asylum procedure, and they're actually assumed to be coming through a safe country. So what we're going to monitor over the coming weeks is not only what the fence is going to do, what the effect of that will be, but also of all those people who are going to be in Hungary still, how they're going to be sent back most likely to Serbia, and then what will happen to them next. But to answer your question clearly, there's other routes already being found. This is constantly going to shift. That's not what's going to stop people coming to Europe.
There is a bit of a question here, Dimitris, as well, of what has been happening in some of the borders before these people reached Budapest. What happened at the border between Greece and Macedonia? What happened at the border between Macedonia and Serbia? What happened on the very border between Serbia and Hungary? Why did we suddenly have a standoff in Budapest train station?
Because the leaders of these countries are trying to negotiate with each other and try to figure out what might be a way out of it. Let's face it, what we're really confronting today is two sets of policies. The one is clear. That policy is made by the refugees. They're the ones who are forcing whatever it is that is happening on the ground. their actions, their aggressiveness in certain way, their plight, the fact that this is all happening in our living rooms, we watch it, we hear it all the time. All of this works to the advantage of something that is irrepressible, that states have to do something. But at the same time, there's a second set of conversations that are taking place, feverish in their own way, that are trying to find this common thread that the European Union perhaps could agree to over the next 10 days. We all know that on the 14th of September, the interior ministers will meet. But this coming Wednesday, in a few days, President Juncker will address the European Parliament, and his address is going to be primarily, if not exclusively, I guess, primarily on the refugee crisis. And he will be asking for 160,000 slots, refugees in other words, that will be redistributed throughout Europe. That is being forced by the facts on the ground, by the refugees themselves, by Angela Merkel.
But hang on then, Dimitris,
by the fact,
if I'm reading what you're saying correctly, then in the meantime, while European leaders try to figure out a common policy, are they basically passing the buck and turning a blind eye, saying, OK, we've got a lot of people showing up at our borders who don't have visas for our countries, but we know that they don't want to stay in our countries, rather than have a face-off at the border in Serbia or Macedonia, let's just let them through and let some other European country pick up the problem.
This is a logical conclusion, and this is really what is happening. What we're talking about here is that the only comparable experience that I can think of in our lifetime is, in a sense, the stampede for the exits after the end of the Vietnam War. Those images that were seen in Hungary and elsewhere remind me of the images of people trying to climb aboard American ships. So this is now uncontrollable for the next 1 or 2 or 3 months. So the only thing, regardless of what agreements the Europeans reach, the only thing that they can do in the next 2 or 3 months is simply find a way to actually allow these people to come in, put them or create some reception centers in a number of different locations and begin to process them. But while they're doing that, hopefully this time they will start thinking about some of the other issues that my colleagues have mentioned, namely, how can they organize that movement so that fewer people lose their lives, so that the publics of this, of the border countries, as it were, in the European Union, do not begin to basically scratch their head and say, who is minding the store? Is there a plan for this? Is right. The next wave going to be always larger than the last wave?
Right.
So there's a lot of work that needs to be done and very little time in which to do it.
There's a lot of work to be done. Jeff, as you know from the UK, not a lot of countries want to do the work on taking in migrants or refugees. Why does it appear that Germany is the most welcoming so far towards refugees? I mean, it was only last month we had in the UK, the UK's Foreign Secretary, Philip Hammond, speaking of the threat to the social infrastructure of Europe posed by migrants. We heard the comments last week from Hungary's Prime Minister talking about the explosive consequences of immigrants who are Muslims rather than Christians. Why is Germany welcoming them?
Well, I think it has a lot to do with Germany's own history. It has to do with the fact that Germany has a relatively strong economy, a strong infrastructure, a need in the future for more labour. So there are some practical as well as some principled reasons why Germany should be a welcoming country. It already has a very substantial immigrant population. Many of the Syrians want to go there because they already have friends or relatives in Germany, which can ease their integration once they get there. But I think one issue we haven't really touched upon, which needs to be thrown into the discussion, is that of public opinion. I think for many, many years, the press and politicians have fed the idea that asylum seekers arriving in Europe are essentially what they call bogus refugees or illegal immigrants. And I think with the Syrians, that's a much harder case to make. And I think what I see across Europe, and particularly here in the UK, is a kind of new recognition that these people are genuine refugees, that they have escaped from terrible persecution and terrible situations of armed conflict, and simply simply putting up walls and fences and barriers to try and keep them out is not the most appropriate response. So I think public opinion is going to be a very major factor in the oncoming discussion, and certainly here in the UK, I think the very rapid change of UK policy on refugee resettlement was very much in response to a new form of public opinion emerging on the scene.
That's an interesting point here. And talking of the facts, perhaps we should get some more facts out. You're right, Jeff. The UN stats at the end of July, for example, indicating that 62% of people reaching Europe by boat are fleeing, you know, war-torn countries like Syria and Afghanistan, or countries of severe persecution like Eritrea. So interesting fact when we get into, you know, who's a refugee and who's a migrant. Gary, I'm wondering, why do most refugees want to go to Germany? Is it because they have family connections? Is it because they're aware of the perhaps a more efficient and welcoming system in Germany? What is it that you hear from people?
Some people say because they have family connections. Also, just to be clear, not everyone wants to go to Germany, actually. There's quite a misunderstanding. There's quite a few people who have connections elsewhere. But most commonly, it's family relationships. It's also because exactly they've heard that that's an option, that it's possible to live there, and that they might be able to find work. There's all sorts of driving factors there. But what's important is that refugees currently coming to Europe know very well that it's a disaster in the border countries right now. I mean, people know that it's terrible in Greece. It is coming worse and worse and worse. We just documented again the horrible conditions on Kos and Lesbos, attacks against migrants, a violent attack that we also witnessed. So things are terrible on those countries. That much they know. So what's clear is that we're going to see onward movement, whether we regulate that or not. And that's really something that needs to sink in.
Well, Gary, so what, let me jump in there on that point. As we see more onward movement, perhaps more and more westwards, because I've tried to dig this up, and it seems that Germany has spoken about how they'll take in Syrians. What about the non-Syrians? Is it clear what will happen to the Afghans? Is it clear what will happen to the Eritreans once they assumedly make it to Germany?
Well, it's not entirely clear, but what is clear is that at least Germany is saying people will have access to a basic asylum procedure. I mean, this is what international law prescribes. This is what these people have a right to, is a fair and individual assessment of whether they are refugees or not. And we certainly don't think only Syrians are refugees. There are many others, and as you mentioned, Afghanistan, Eritrea, but also people from other countries could be refugees. So what they're entitled to, what they need, and what at least Germany says they will provide, is a basic assessment, a procedure, access to a process to decide whether people are or aren't refugees.
Dimitrios, when you read some of the headlines in the papers, you read some of the statements that, like I mentioned, of politicians, you get the idea that Europe is virtually being threatened with invasion or collapse by the flow of refugees. Is that the reality, though? When we look at, for example, Lebanon or Jordan, I mean, Lebanon's taken in the equivalent of a quarter of its population. It hasn't collapsed. Jordan, and another, you know, not an oil-rich resource country, says it's taken in the equivalent of a fifth of its population. They haven't collapsed. How much of this is fact and how much of it is scaremongering?
Well, some of it is scaremongering. The words invasion and other things like that, for those people that use them, they're intended to sort of convey a certain image and as a result, you know, create a certain response. I think relative to what it is that the first asylum countries, you mentioned Lebanon, you mentioned Jordan, but Turkey, we're forgetting that the most extraordinary response in all [S2] Right. [S1] Of this has been that of Turkey. All of these countries have a legitimate claim, a legitimate argument when they say, we're the ones, we didn't cause this, we're the ones who are dealing with the vast majority of the consequences, over 90% or thereabouts of the refugees are basically coming into our countries. We're not rich countries.
Right.
And now that we have created, in a sense, a flow that leaves our countries to come to Europe, Europe is beginning to complain about all this.
All right, we're going
to have to. That's legitimate. At the same time.
Right, right. I'm sorry, because we are running out of time. I just want to pose a final fact here for thought. A March 27th study by the Bertelsmann Institute found Germany, for example, needs around 500,000 new immigrants every year until the year 2050 just to maintain its workforce. Just something to keep in mind, perhaps, as we discuss whether refugees and migrants are a threat or not. Let's thank our guests very much for their insight into the discussion. From Oxford, Jeff Crisp. In London, Gauri Van Gulik. And in Washington, D.C., Dimitris Papadimitriou. And thank you for watching. You can contact us by going to our program page on our website, aljazeera.com. You can post a comment on facebook.com/AJInsideStory. You can also send us a tweet at AJInsideStory. From me, Sami Zeidan, and the whole team, for now, it's goodbye.